Welcome to Book Club for Movies, everybody. It is October 4th. I'm Ryan Miller, and he doesn't hate me. He's just pissed off at me. It's Matt Amberg.
It's a good line. I do like that line.
It is. I think we'll come back to it.
I think we might.
I had another one. You want me to use the other one?
Sure. Let's try it.
Okay. It's not often I get to use your name, so I thought I was kind of torn, but okay.
That's good, because, yeah, character's name.
And I see for a living, Matt. It's what I do. It's Matt Amberg.
That actually is that's one of the quotes I have.
You got
pulled.
That one too? Okay,
yeah,
all right.
I like that
we'll
one.
We'll come back to both of them.
All right.
It's Book Club for Movies, guys. We watch a movie every single week. We hope you do too, and we hope you talk to us about it. podcast@bookclubformovies.com. This week, it's Kodachrome.
It's Kodachrome.
Thank yous to Adam Parkin,
nice
listener and movie file, Canadian movie file.
Of summers makes you think all
for recommending this movie. We watched it, and it's your
sunny
fault.
Day, oh yeah.
But what's it about, Matt?
So, Mama,
or did
don't
you already
take
sing it to us?
My Kodachrome away. What? I didn't hear anything. I was over here singing.
That's fair. No, that's fine. I've heard you do synopses.
Oh, sure. Kodachrome. Wait.
No, that's it. You got it. We watched the same movie this week. Again, we've had an amazing streak of being on the same page. Actually, that's not true. We did fail for Smokey and the Bandit once. Okay, we failed once. We've failed once. ZeroHitPoints.com. I'll change the subtitle later.
Here we go. Kodachrome coming at you. An hour and 45 minutes. Written by Jonathan Tropper. Directed by Mark Razzo. Starring Ed Harris, Jason Sudeikis, and Elizabeth Olsen.
Mm-hmm.
When a failing music executive is met by his father's dying nurse with a request to drive cross-country in order to get four rolls of Kodachrome developed at the last photo store that can, he's forced to reconcile the father that was never there, his relationships that have failed, and whether or not he can learn to forgive them and himself.
Okay. Well, pretty good. A little more serious than normal, maybe.
It is. This movie here threw me for a bit of a loop.
Yeah, sounds like.
Yeah.
And I'll leave that up to you, how much of the loop we get into.
Oh, I will get into that. I will absolutely.
The loop?
Yeah, yeah.
360 degrees.
I will loop it. I'm
all
loopy.
Right. Hey.
No, this is one of those moments you're going to get later in the show where you're going to get some real honesty, some brutal honesty about who I am. And this movie, again, really, it threw me for a loop. It did a number on me.
This movie, I think, deserves it. You know, it's very unassuming. In fact, I had not heard of it before it was recommended to us. I'll be honest.
Sure.
I had, of course, heard of Ed Harris and Jason Sudeikis and Elizabeth Olsen.
Sure.
All accomplished in their own rights.
Yeah, all in the Marvel universe.
In fact, we've done a Sudeikis movie. Yeah, I don't think we've done an Ed Harris movie, but we did Colossal, wherein Sudeikis was fantastic.
Yeah, I love that. I love that role.
I think it comes back.
I love that role because I love having seen him in that and then seeing him in this.
Well, and you're forgetting seeing him in Saturday Night Live.
Well, no. I mean, those are like, I already know that I love him as a comedian. I know
sure.
that I like him that way. But you know, he's not a comedian in Colossal.
No. And it's hard to say that these roles aren't impactful because of that, I guess, is all.
Oh,
I'm
sure,
saying.
Sure.
Yeah.
But I do love seeing the huge difference between the characters that he's playing and but also seeing correlations between the two, like seeing
for sure. Yeah, in fact, I have that down as well. We'll get there for
that's
sure.
That's funny.
Maybe the easiest way to start this off is the same way the movie starts off,
mm-hmm.
because there are very specific impetuses to pretty much every action. It seems like it puts stuff in motion very early on. Jason Sudeikis is a what would you call that? Music executive.
He's a
of
music
sorts.
Exec. Yeah.
Okay.
That's what he is.
He's signing bands, except his main band, his money ticket, as it were, has since dropped him. He goes to the show and they're like, sorry, we signed with somebody else. Jason Sudeikis goes back to work and he's being let go. Except as kind of a last ditch, and you never know how truthful this is, he says, I am in talks with this one band that the label would be over the moon to get. And I don't want to undersell anything, but I guess that's why we get into it later for an hour. He's basically given the ultimatum, okay, you've got 2 weeks. And if you can't get this band, you are really out of here.
Yeah.
Within that same time period, in fact, minutes later, as he's walking back to his office, Elizabeth Olsen walks in and is his estranged father's nurse, caretaker, friend, it seems. and gives their ultimatums that, number one, he's got some rolls of Kodachrome, like you mentioned, that he wants to develop. Number two, he's dying. He's got cancer. So he's also probably got about 2 weeks, it seems, to get stuff done. Either one of these things, die or develop Kodachrome. So the movie is very nakedly, it's very nakedly about a lot of things, but it's at the outset, like this is less than 10 minutes into the film, we get both of these ultimatums, both of these impetuses. Impetuses? Impeti.
Impeti. That's
impotence. No, I went there. And for the most part, stays true to them, mm-hmm. but they are very kind of simple. You know, the movie starts off very simply.
I think ultimately this is not a, like, thematically and the way it runs, it's not overly complicated. It's a very simple story. I think that it's just a story that resonates very easily.
Yeah. All the terms I would use for it, I feel, are too dismissive. It's well-worn.
Right.
You know, watch the trailer. Like, you're not going to be surprised really by anything plot-wise.
The only thing that might catch you is you might not figure out what's on the rolls of film before
I figured
developed.
It out. This would be funny because I feel like you figure stuff out way before me all the time. I figured it out 10 minutes in.
Yeah. So
I mean, I shouldn't say figured it out. It was my number one competing thing about what's on the film.
Yeah. So I went a totally different direction and didn't figure it out until a little over halfway through the movie. And then I beat you on one movie.
we will get into the ending. Let's put it that way. Because sure. I think the ending could have gone a bunch of different ways. In fact, that's maybe where you innovate with this story. Since it is kind of not surprising. Mm-hmm. And this is, I think, by design still. It starts out simply. It has these ultimatums. And the story isn't anything special. Because then guess what it gets to do? It gets to let Sudeikis, Olsen, and freaking Ed Harris do their thing.
And holy crap. Like,
and do they, right?
Every single one of them turns in a great performance here.
Amazing.
I
Well, let's start with Sudeikis then. Yeah, and we've already got halfway there with what we're talking about. As Elizabeth Olsen comes up to Sudeikis and says that his father wants him to take this trip with him, he, of course, blows them completely off, and she is able to kind of crack the facade a little bit with just the line, he's dying. Like, this is it.
Yeah.
Like, you won't see him again. And it's enough to get him to dinner there that night. But in between then, with that conversation and at that dinner that night, you see Sudeikis from Colossal in that, and spoiler alerts for Colossal, he's a villain.
Mm-hmm.
You see Sudeikis be brutal in Colossal in a way that's glorious.
Yeah.
And that comes back here. Like that was one of my first nights was, man, Sudeikis can just be brutal. Like, he's got that.
Yeah.
And it's not sardonic because, you know, you see his comedy and you think sardonic. He's brutal.
No, and he sells that. Like he does. He does the good job. I think, and the sardonic part is, I think, right on, because what he does really well is he does a very good job of playing the damaged emotional person that really has to say a joke at every, like, he's got to turn it into a gag. And he does it in such a way where it's, you know what he's doing and you know why, you get it. Cause everybody's done it. Everybody has gotten into a position where I'm just going to throw a zinger out there and it's probably not going to land, but yeah, you know, I think a lot of people have lived that he does that. And I think this is, you know, he has that here, in a number of spots.
It's knee jerk in a way that other actors can't pull off. Obviously.
Yeah. Know? Here's what I think he does that I don't think we see from enough actors. And maybe it's a little inside baseball. I don't know. There is a difference between going out and acting and doing a performance and actually being there. Okay. And when you're actually there, you know all your lines, and it doesn't matter if you know theirs, but you're listening to them. You're hearing what they're saying to you. You are paying attention. Because what they're saying to you, even though you have a delivered line, you know what you're going to say. You listen to that because the inflection, the way it's said, the looks on the faces, that's going to change every single time. You cannot in your life make the same face over and over and over again. It's not possible. Something will change. A hair is out of place. Your lip doesn't sit right. And I think this is a cast of people that listen before they respond. So they're hearing that, like,
which sounds dumb, but try doing that in a acting sense, right?
Like, it's really hard, and it's really hard because there you have to remember your lines, but you're also focusing on hearing what they're saying. And there is, like, for a lot of people, I know I'm probably at a point where I can't do it again. I probably have to learn it over again. But there is a break there, and sometimes you can't have that break. Sometimes you need to respond right away. And there's a change going from, I heard what you're saying, to now I'm going to respond. And I'm going to respond not only in kind, I am going to respond based on how you gave your line to me.
And in character.
And there are, look, you know who somebody I absolutely think has a problem with this is Leonardo DiCaprio. No. I am serious. Like, Leonardo DiCaprio.
No, I know you're serious,
but
I mean, ladies and gentlemen, this is why we have him. You're bringing real world experience here and bringing it to bear on Leonardo DiCaprio, as you should.
And again, I don't want to say that like, I understand he is a good actor, and he can be a great actor at times. I think more often than not, I don't see him listening so much as I see him waiting to give his line.
Sure.
And I see that in, like, The Departed, I see it, which I think is the worst one for me because I like that movie.
I love The Departed. Yeah.
But if you, like, watch him, and it's so often to me, like, think about it. Think about how.
In fact, I'd still say that's his best movie. But yeah, actually, I think where we diverge on DiCaprio is that I still enjoy him.
Right.
And that breaks it for you.
And, yeah. And I don't
know if I disagree with anything you've said so far, though.
But going back to Kodachrome, you have three actors here that they look like they're engaged with each other at all times. There aren't a whole bunch of moments in here where I didn't feel like they weren't actually engaged.
Yeah. Yeah, in fact, there were moments I wondered how, and I tried to look it up. There's not a lot about this online, but there were moments where I wondered if it was mostly improvised. Actually, there were a couple Sudeikis. There was Sudeikis and Olsen outside the hotel because they do convince him to go. There's another caretaker of his father's who's able to pull some strings and it gets him the meeting with the band if he will go on this trip with his father. So he goes on the trip with his father, and there's a scene outside of their first hotel room where it's Sudeikis and Olsen that I was like, man, that almost seemed just completely off the cuff.
Yeah.
And it's good.
It's great. So yeah. So let's keep going. Let's keep moving
forward. All right.
Forward.
Let's keep going.
I think we've nailed Sudeikis here. I think we've kind of. Do you have anything more to say about him?
No. I mean, I guess I'll have more to say about the characters, and
sure.
I guess that's where we are going from here. Is that this movie is character driven? It's allowed to take its time with the characters. Like, there were several times I looked, and I hate that I do this. It's part of why I hate the digital age. One of the reasons I hate the digital age is because I'll look at how much is remaining or how much I've seen in the movie so far. Uh-huh. I try to tell myself it's instructive because I'm thinking act structure and stuff like that, because
film school,
you know, where are the deviations taken? And, you know, anyways, but there were multiple times I looked at that and I was like, what else are they going to do? And it's because it is character driven. You know, you don't know where the characters are going to go, even if you've seen these characters in a lot of things before.
Yeah.
It's a lot less predictable. And maybe I was making up for predictability here, because everything else is basically predictable. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Did that answer whatever? I can't remember what we were talking about.
Great. No, great.
Perfect. I have nothing more about Sudeikis other than what we'll get into with the story.
Sure.
If we want to move on to Elizabeth Olsen, then we might have covered her too.
I guess what I want to say about Elizabeth Olsen is, I had to take some time with her. I liked her at the beginning. I was fine with her, and I was seeing that she's good. She's very great to a point, like in that first part. I wasn't quite sure how I was going to feel about her as she kept going. I like her a lot. She has been in a few movies that I think is absolutely spectacular. And Ingrid Goes West.
Infinity War. Avengers Age of Ultron.
mostly
Civil War.
Mostly Ingrid Goes West. But Ingrid Goes West, she's incredible in that. I think that there's a moment where she and Jason Sudeikis are having a discussion about their exes and what happened in their relationships. And she gives this speech about keeping it together and how in all these places, it's just so hard and you just have to fake it till you make it type thing. And it's a great conversation between the two about like, and it's very instructive about where she is in her romantic world. And you get a kind of an instructive bit from Sudeikis there as well about where he's at. And it was that moment where they were sitting on the bed. And it's
yeah,
the,
yeah.
I'm dead on for you.
It's a great moment. It's great writing. It's great performance, surrounded by what I disliked most. And what I have to say about Elizabeth Olsen is in terms of her relationship with Jason Sudeikis' character, mm-hmm. Matt. Talked about this up top.
Sure.
But it's because that moment is there's a romance, and I so badly did not want that to be a thing in the movie. I didn't want it to be, because the push and pull of this movie for me in my head was how much of it is manufactured and how much of it are they still able to pull off? Because there's obvious setup, you know, and then they're obviously the two. There's maybe hints about how close she is with his father, so that might make it weird. But yes, they're set up to come together and have a relationship. And I love that moment, but it starts off with him. They both had a little bit to drink. He comes into the room. They go through all these lines to get him sitting on the bed with her. And it's super awkward, and you can tell. And I would say even the performances fail at that point. And then he tries to kiss her, and then he falls off the bed. And then they have the great moment. I don't think I needed him trying to kiss her. And
no.
I mean... We'll get into it as the movie goes, but I didn't even think I needed that relationship. I would have rather they connected as great friends with similar past experiences, you know, because they both
Agreed.
Come from people that have left them, or they left relationships or something like that. So
I was thankful that throughout the movie, it's not permeated. It's kind of here
that
and there.
That is true.
It doesn't really, it to me, like that one sequence is great. And I will actually disagree with you. I think that, having there are a lot of parts in there that I can identify with that I very clearly understood. And I agree with you in the one sense that I hated the, I'm going to lean in to kiss you cause I'm drunk. Like
It wasn't necessary, but then I extend that to the whole relationship. I just don't think there's a part, like she disappears at the third act because they finally, spoiler alert guys, they finally sleep together and it blows up like it should. And part
which
of me thinks
father,
that that's,
which his father calls out, by the way.
Well, he calls out that they slept together because they like,
no.
He falls asleep on the floor that night and they wake up and he sees them.
Yeah.
He sees his son. So he's like, oh, you guys are screwing. And we'll get to Ed Harris.
But he calls out that you guys, you know, if you do this, it's going to blow up in your face.
Oh yes. I guess that's true.
He does. Yeah. He calls
maybe,
that out.
Maybe that does lend to his character, but not that character is done so well and so much with, like, it's the anchor of the movie.
Yeah. I'm just saying that it was one of those things that you saw coming, and you saw it coming. Partially because he outright told you it was coming.
Well,
you
know? Maybe that's what I'm saying is I feel like it's almost what, like they were like, she needs to be gone by the third act, which sure. I mean, there is growth that needs to happen between the father and the son without her. Mm-hmm. That makes sense. But it's almost like they're like, well, what if we have them, you know, fall in love and then eventually get together? And that's the blow up that leads to her leaving the movie for a while. Mm-hmm. Like, okay, that, you know, I think you could have still done it a different way. But I don't know. What, armchair, whatever, this and that. It's my main quibble with the movie, maybe, actually,
sure.
Is that relationship. So
fair enough. That part landed for me kind of as a whole outside of the kissy kissy rapey rapey thing. I'm just not a fan of it.
Well, it's not pulled off well either, because that happens and she kind of backs up from the kiss and he falls off in that action, and then they both laugh about it. I'm like
she kicks him off the bed.
Does she? Okay.
Yeah. Whatever. It wasn't that he just falls off. She actually like moves him. And that's why she's
but it's
like
so laughy. It's like
and that makes sense because they're drunk. You know,
I guess,
I get what you're saying. I it worked for me.
That's fine.
And I think that's all for Elizabeth Olsen. She's very strong.
I mean, she's obviously turning in something way more deep than any Avenger movie. And I have not seen the movie you mentioned that I've even forgotten already.
Ingrid Goes West.
Gotcha. Okay. Hey, anybody holding their own in this movie against Ed Harris? They're going places.
Yeah, you kidding me? And these two, like her especially though, she really holds her own with him. Like their back and forths are pretty good. Like they can be pretty funny, but there are moments where you really, really believe that Ed Harris's character cannot live without her.
Yeah, all credit to Elizabeth Olsen here. She is in this story, and we'll get back into the story by way of Ed Harris, and then we can talk about his character. She is in the story to give us more shades of Ed Harris because she cares about, and Ed Harris's character's name is Ben. I actually remember, so I should use it. Mm-hmm. She gives us more shades of Ben. They obviously get along. They love each other to some degree. Mm-hmm. She is his nurse. Like she's taking care of him. And there is that moment where when they have the moment where he falls off the bed and he spends the night in there, they are woken up that morning by him falling down in the bathroom and her rushing to his aid and being like, I need to take care of you. Like, whatever. Are you okay? All this stuff. We get another cut. Actually, before that, we get a cut of them playing cards on the bed in their hotel room. Later, Sudeikis.
Yeah, which is, and that's one of those also instructive, but really, really, really subtle, well done moments by
nice
Sudeikis,
touch.
Because Sudeikis catches them, and he is still at a point where I don't even want to be here. I don't want to be here right now. I don't get along with my dad. And then he walks past, and he sees these two people laughing and playing cards.
Yeah, he sees somebody enjoying his father's company.
And there is definitely a twinge there. It's just so subtly there of jealousy and sad.
And it's early on too.
Yeah.
And yeah, Sudeikis has it. Plot-wise, they end up at Ben's brother's house, which happened to be the brother that raised Sudeikis and they're never particularly clear about it, but at some point his mom passed away, I think when he was 13.
Yes.
And he was... No, his dad was already gone. His dad is a photographer.
His dad was gone.
And he was gone and didn't even come back for the funeral. So Sudeikis ended up with his brother, Uncle
not Sam Elliott.
No, Uncle not Sam. It's Bruce Greenwood.
It's Bruce Greenwood.
Everybody knows Bruce Greenwood.
Yeah, but he ain't Sam Elliott. You know they wanted Sam Elliott for this.
Well,
when you
put a mustache on for us.
They
put a handlebar on for us.
When somebody puts that mustache on, you know, it's just them saying we couldn't get Sam Elliott. Like, that's all that is.
Not taking away anything from Bruce Greenwood.
No, he was actually, his little bit part here, great.
Yeah, you know why he's there, because he gets it done too.
He does.
But basically, it creates a situation you think it would create wherein, I mean, number one, we get that line, because they're on the way, and he's like, okay, we'll go to his house, and it's Uncle Dean is his name. It's like, but Uncle Dean hates you. And that's when he gives the line, Uncle Dean doesn't hate me, he's just pissed off at me. And I think it's literally the line the movie toys with, because it's you get words for what Sudeikis has been doing up till then and will continue to do for a little while longer. Is basically try and decide if he hates his father or if he's just pissed off at him. You know,
sure.
That is the line that this movie dwells in.
I think you're right. I think you know what? I didn't even consider that, but you're right. Absolutely.
It is. It's there's a reason it's spoken. And Ed Harris says a lot of things. Most of it antagonistic. But he is given the gems, and you would do that.
Oh, of course, yeah. and let's not undersell this. That character is coarse, and he is
beyond coarse. Yeah.
He is in some ways he's a little mean. He is no way I would never categorize him as a kind person. The guy he's basically a jerk. He is.
We're keeping it family friendly. I appreciate that, Matt. Yeah. He's basically a jerk. He soft terms even for him, I would say.
Oh yeah, yeah. He's
and actually he admits that at one point. He's like, oh, so you know you're a jerk. He's like, of course I know I'm
a
jerk.
Yeah, of course I know I'm a jerk.
So they end up at the dinner table where maybe the most crass moment happens in which Ben alludes to having slept with Bruce's, Uncle Dean's wife before they were married or whatever, but sure, bring that up at the dinner table. He does it to cause an explosion, which is what that guy does, what that character does. And it works.
And within that explosion that occurs, Ed Harris has this line where they ask him, about the photographs that he's taken. He's got, and he says, yeah, I remember every photograph I've ever taken. And that is exactly who that person is, because Jason Sudeikis, in this very, like, it just takes a minute, and he's just sitting there and he says, what's my birthday?
It's great.
And he
can't come back with it.
No. And there's nothing like it is just one of those moments of you have a perfect understanding right here about why Jason Sudeikis feels that way and exactly who Ed Harris is.
It's great writing. It's a really great line. In fact, and that happens before the explosion where he lets the bomb drop or whatever.
Which I think is that was the point. He lets the bomb drop so he doesn't have to think about this.
Well, and I think it's beautiful because they didn't turn that into the explosion. Like, that becomes a beautiful moment. Like, the cut after that, Uncle Dean says his birthday because he knows his birthday because he raised him. Yeah. But the cut after that is just Sudeikis walking back into the kitchen to talk to his surrogate mother for a while. Like, there is no typical explosion right there. That comes later when he says the stupid thing. But yeah, that's what makes it. And I think, in fact, that's what I would probably give most of this movie, is that the moments, the explosions, again, I keep calling them explosions, but the outbursts, I guess, means so much more because this movie isn't afraid of the small moments. And it's not afraid of the small moments from the very beginning.
Yeah, yeah.
I will take exception with the music in some of those small moments only. I don't know if it's because this movie is very much about music in a lot of different ways.
Oh, man.
And it's not the licensed stuff either. Like, that gets hokey. It gets overdone for sure. And when I say licensed, it's like a band singing a song, you know?
Oh, I will tell you the one that really I cringed at.
Okay, well, I cringed at all the small moments that were beautiful small moments. And it doesn't do this with all the small moments. But then it adds like a weird, it's like TV, not sitcom, it's like TV drama kind of interstitial music. You know, like they're coming back to the house in the middle after the commercial or something like that. Yeah, I'm like, that had me cringing.
Yeah, it was the use of, and I don't think, I don't, I will legitimately say this, I never, ever, anybody making a movie, don't ever use this song. Do not ever use that Eddie Vedder song. Like, don't. It is, it's a nice song. It's a sweet song. It is so, like, sappy.
Is it the father song or something? Oh, is it Eddie Vedder? Oh, got it. Okay.
I like that song. It's a fine song. It is so on the nose for any movie that, no, just don't use that for anything in any movie ever. Please, never.
Yeah, fair enough. And this that might be, did I already say something was its greatest failure in this movie? I did. It was the relationship. Okay, music a close second.
Yeah, fair enough.
But they get back on the road. There is that blow up. They do leave the house on the heels of that. And do they have a next stop, or are we basically into the end of the, we probably should be into the end of this after.
Yeah, we're getting close to it. It is after this though, is that one line. Yeah, of course I know I'm a jerk. And then he makes the point, all great artists are. And he is, for all intents and purposes in this film, all we know is that he's a photographer, and that based on the other person, the Allstate guy, David Hayter. I kept thinking he was going to offer insurance. It never happened.
Too bad, because he's good.
David Hayter makes a good point. He, you know, he kind of makes it. He kind Dennis of makes Haysbert. It a little clear that his father is a well-known photographer. He's not just a guy who takes pictures. This is what his life was.
But I feel like Matt, Jason Sudeikis' character, knows that. Like, that's never in doubt.
Well, no. But I think that's it's the feeding that to us. And his excuse for leaving, his excuse for being gone, is that, well, I can't be a great artist if I'm with you. I can't be a great artist if I'm at home.
Okay.
And
yeah,
and he mentioned
that rings true.
They mention with the mother's funeral, the reason he can't come home or won't is because he's in like Africa.
Yeah, it was a once in a lifetime thing or something like that. Yeah.
Right. And it's like, you know, once in a lifetime thing, once in a lifetime person. I'm still gonna be the artist.
Yeah, know? And maybe I guess, I mean, you're right. That permeates the film. So I guess I don't know why that seems. They dig into that character so deeply at times that I guess maybe that's why, is because that's mostly him being a great photographer is kind of surface level. And that's the first thing we get about that character.
It is completely used as a, Like, it's a background device. It's never, ever put up front. Like, he's back there. You see him all the time screwing with his camera. He takes some pictures. He puts film in it. And you see the deterioration of him through that. Like, he, as he has more a harder time adding film to the camera. And but it's
true. Yeah,
it's,
yeah.
It's there. But the photography is never, like, it's never at the forefront. It's always about... I mean, it is, but it's
number one, to build the ending, but also, yeah, I think you're right, and I think it's a smart decision, because obviously we are... delving into the character of the photographer is far less interesting than delving into the character of the father, which... So that makes sense why it's maybe a little mixed up in my mind. And honestly, I think it's a little mixed up in my mind because it is so multi-layered. Like, they do a lot of different things. There were moments where Ed Harris's character is... at least three different things to three different people.
Oh, yeah.
And seeing that builds out that character in a way better way than, you know, just watching him and Sudeikis bounce off each other for an hour and a half would have. So, well, hey, somebody knows what they're doing somewhere. It's not me.
And something you mentioned here that I want to talk about just briefly.
Okay.
Is that... the Ed Harris character, because you said the layers, and it's not just about the photographer. And I think the interesting thing here is that this is like and this is such a weird analogy, and you're going to laugh at it too. This is like watching a movie about Batman, but it's Bruce Wayne. Because give me a minute. I'll get it out there. It's a bad analogy, but I'm going to use it anyways. I'm owning
Bat
it.
Bat analogy.
The photographer part of him is Batman. And with Batman, in so many ways, Batman is not the facade. Batman isn't the costume. In so many ways, Batman is who Bruce Wayne is. And Bruce Wayne is the costume.
Yeah, sure. Yeah,
and in this way, like, I think that you're right. It's a better story about the father. And that's what we get. What we never got, or what we get actually, no. We get the being the father thing, but in being the father, he still has that facade up. He's still the photographer. He's still the artist. He still has that Batman face on, for all intents and purposes.
Well, I mean,
because that's who he is.
It is, and not one of those things changes the other thing.
Right,
and that's
right.
A real person, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, we don't get some. And let's get to the ending. I think we've done our due diligence here.
Sure.
It all comes to a head at the hospital, where he does have a fall and he has to go to the hospital. They find him in the hotel room passed out after Elizabeth Olsen leaves, and he's broken down physically, spiritually, mentally. And they finally have the conversation that basically the movie's been building to. It's Ed Harris's moment, and he nails it.
Yeah.
Wherein he basically, it might be too on the nose, like a lot of the movie is, but
it works.
It's
that's
perfectly
the thing.
Delivered. And it works. And maybe I'll get to that right now. There were moments for a lot of this movie where I was hoping it would work by the end. Like, a lot was riding on the end by the time it got there.
Yeah.
Because it was so predictable. I was like, well, is it still going to work? Or is it just going to have a predictable ending? And we'll get more into the ending. But I think the fact that it did face it head on made it work. And Ed Harris pulls out the line, you know, I don't know what broke along the way. Speaking about himself, yeah. You know, he gives a great couple memories of time with Sudeikis when he was a kid.
Yeah.
And he talks about how, you know, holding him as a kid, that would be the one moment he would choose to last forever. It's really good writing too. I don't
it
want
is,
to take away
yeah.
from it.
No.
And it arrives at Sudeikis, at Matt, and they hug. And in that moment, I'm like, okay, number one, they pulled it off.
Yeah.
And number two, what they pulled off was love grows amongst the weeds. That was just, I don't know if that's probably been said somewhere, and that's probably why it was in my head already, but just that concept, and it landed. It happened. They did it. Like, they succeed. The movie succeeds.
I love that. And this is a really, like, I wrote this down early on, and it is, it's very on the nose, right? This is super on the nose. The movie is called Kodachrome. It's about a father and a son developing their relationship. literally going across the country to develop a relationship. Ridiculous, right?
I'm more angry that I didn't think of that.
So
actually.
So there are a couple of one of the thing I want to mention before we just jump into the ending.
Ending.
And this happens So they're in the hospital bed, and at that point the doctors tell him he can't leave. This is where he's going to die. You have maybe a couple of days. And they have their discussion, and Sudeikis says, we're getting them developed. We're going to go do it. And takes them out of the hospital. They head down, they drop the film off, they go back to their hotel, and that is the first moment where Sudeikis sees his dad for what he is to everybody else, because he is suddenly surrounded by who are supposed to be incredible photographers that are there for this thing. They're there because it's the last time the Kodachrome is going to be developed. And these people recognize him, and they come and talk to him. And he has this line where he says that he's talking about photography, and he says, you know, we time is always moving, and we stop time, and we make human nature tangible. And I think that, like, that line and that whole discussion there, that monologue that he kind of gives back and forth to Sudeikis, like the camera kind of goes back and forth between the two. And then that line.
Yeah, because you get to see Sudeikis observe this. Like, again, and this is one of the moments I spoke of where he's being something else to, like, we knew he was the photographer, but we get to see what that meant to other people in this moment. And Sudeikis gets to see that. And again, it's you know, that character is arriving at him.
So there's a couple things here that run in my head, that he says, human nature made tangible. This is a moment for Jason Sudeikis where his father is like, he sees something new. And what is the one thing he can't do or doesn't do because it's not him? He doesn't take a picture. At no point does Jason Sudeikis take a picture. He never has a photo with his father. He never does it ever. At any point in this movie, he never does that. And that's the point where I almost look at it as like, he sees it and he understands what's going on. And he's taking that, like, it's totally that mental picture. This is how I'm going to remember him the most.
Yeah.
Like,
how do you show a mental picture? They do it pretty darn well.
Right. Human nature made tangible. It's great. Now, great. Okay, let's get into the third act here. So,
okay. Well, no, I'm going to roll in from what you've just said then.
Go.
So they don't ever have a physical picture together. This movie does dwell on what a photograph is, both literally and figuratively. And they do end up in the hotel room after this, and that's where he finally passes away. Ben finally passes away. And there are basically a series of moments after that, because it's shot really well. He walks into the hotel. Like, we see Ed Harris at the table trying to put some film in again, and then he just looks up like he's seen a ghost and says, "Do you hear that?" And then we go to Sudeikis, the camera. There's lots of great long shots, actually, in this film, I should mention.
Yeah.
But this is all one take. Comes into Sudeikis as he comes into the hotel room, and then follows Sudeikis as he goes from speaking to his father. And this is why this is why you do takes like this, because you get to watch a person change, you know? Yeah. So he follows him to a chair where he sits down and has come to realize that his dad has finally passed on. And we get one of the first moments where I maybe would have ended the shot shorter than this thing does. It eventually pulls out, and you see Ed Harris kind of slumped over the chair. I kind of would have ended just on Sudeikis' face, especially since he nailed the moment. But that's fine. We get to see Ed Harris.
So if I were going to end the movie there, it wouldn't be on Sudeikis' face.
Well, not the movie, just that scene.
So that scene, you know what? I totally understand what you're saying. But I actually really love the "Okay, Dad."
Oh, I like that. Wait, does he say that when Ed Harris? Well, I like that's the line too. That's what he says too. When
his dad
dies.
His dad dies, and he sits down. He has that face, and he says, "Okay, Dad."
But they hadn't shown Ed Harris yet, I think, is what I'm saying.
No, I think that it's a two shot.
Is it a two shot? Finally, at that point?
I think so. I think so.
I do love that line. I guess I'm just, and this is, it's all quibbles and it's all armchair and
sure.
Like I said already, I think the movie succeeds. The bigger question mark, I think, was whether or not we saw the film. Actually, at one point I was questioning whether or not he would pick up the film, but they solved that by having the guy deliver the film to him.
Yeah.
You know, but there's a beauty in the pictures not mattering, right. Which now that I think back to the entire film, I guess that was never going to happen.
No.
But I don't know. Maybe you build it up to not show them, you know? So it's...
Well, okay.
I think there's a movie where you just never see what's on those rolls.
So this is not that movie though.
It is not.
We see what's on the rolls, and this is a moment where, man, that cinematography for me, the color and everything, and the way sure. they, especially the very last three shots where they doot and get closer.
Well, so that's another moment, because he takes the film to his father's apartment and he starts watching it on the slides.
And they're all slides.
Number one, they are photos of that moment he said he would pause forever. So it's great. It is. But then Elizabeth Olsen shows up and
but then again, Elizabeth Olsen
shows up. Well, I mean, it was a beautiful moment and I do like her character, but I don't know.
So
I think it's just all ruined by the previous relationship. Like, she still could have shown up and been, because especially her line, would you like some company? Yeah, I would. It's not like, hey, you know, do you want to get married or something like that? It's, would you like some company? Like, they didn't need it. And the thing you're talking about where it's the series of shots that are slides, it's coming up on both of them as they're watched from behind, as they're watching the things. It is all beautiful.
So
sure. But so, again, maybe I would have ended.
I can go both ways on that part in particular with Elizabeth Olsen coming in. The reason I think it works so well is because, not because of Sudeikis's character, not because of Matt, but because of Ben. She comes back to his apartment where Matt is, because she and him have now, like, yes, they had their fling, but on a very different level, they have a very True. Different connection. And for her to come in and say, do you want some company, as opposed to anything else? I think that is very much so in line with that character, and it fits for me. Because,
sure, no, and I love it. I think it's just the stuff before that so, obviously is coloring my view. But.
So here is where, man, I don't even know if I'll get through this without a little bit. Those slides. So I don't there are not a lot of pictures of my dad. And there are like three with the two of us, and I only have one of them. And one of them I think is gone. And that part, like that part seriously, like, resonated with me in a very real way. Like, I bawled. I was like, this is nothing. I cried my eyes out. Like, I was like, and it was funny because I was like trying not to cry. And it was, you know, tears and everything. And I stood up and I said, I like that movie. Like, right as after the credits rolled, I like that movie. And Beth said something along the lines of, she made some like off kilter joke about an earlier line from the movie that was like super goofy. And I looked at her and I said, no, because I miss my dad. And she immediately went, "Welp," you know, she, "No," but yeah, like, the movie worked for me all the way through. I really, really enjoyed it. That last part,
Agreed.
It just sealed it for me. Like, that is a movie I will probably watch multiple times throughout my life, because I identify in so many ways with all those characters for different reasons. Yeah. And at that very end, like, I identify heavily with those last little bits, you know?
Yeah, yeah. For all my woulda, shoulda, couldas, like, at the end there, it does still succeed, and I did still thoroughly enjoy it. So yeah, I mean, you want to see a good movie that does end without seeing the guy, the dead guy last, go watch Birdman. That's, you want a Birdman? Oh, there God. Is a Birdman out there.
That freak. We should do a show on Birdman.
Okay. All right. I uttered the name of Birdman. Tell you what, though. And I can't believe this is true. Kodachrome got 300 stars.
Out of 303.
So it's pretty good.
Pretty good, guys. So that was Kodachrome. Thanks that for listening Kodachrome. On this. We are available podcast@bookclubformovies.com. You know where to find us. You know what to do. We're on Twitter, Book Club for
Man,
Movies.
Man, we spent some time on Kodachrome. Good job, Adam.
Yeah, we love it. Good job, Canadian.
See what happens
Adam.
When you tell us to watch a movie?
Yeah, we watch it and talk about
watch
it a lot.
Watch the hell out of it.
That was a lot of fun. Now, normally this is the part where I would say, here's what's coming up as our next selection. But what I'm going to do instead is say, we're going to go to the rest of the show. And in doing so, we're going to explain our next book club for movie selection.
We're all T's on this episode. Look at us. I only have like two and a half movies to talk about. It's going to be quick. I did the Almighty duology, as some have called it, Bruce Almighty and Evan Almighty.
Great.
Bruce Almighty, I think, is some later era, but perfectly serviceable and quite funny Jim Carrey.
There's some good parts to it.
Evan Almighty also has some really great Steve Carell in there. I think the story itself is far less, there's a lot less there if you're not religious.
Yes, that movie, especially for somebody like me, it's funny.
But yes, some good funny Steve Carell. I did laugh out loud a number of times.
Sure. I haven't seen it in a long time, but I liked it.
But the movie I actually ended up in the theater for, and there's a little bit of a funny story behind it. Every now and then I try to do a daddy-daughter date, as nobody's been able to come up with a better word for it. And, you know, you take the kid out, you get to know her.
Seems dubious.
Number one, she chose everything. So we ate at Hometown Buffet.
She just wanted pudding, didn't she?
Oh, man. She goes, no, actually, she gets the pizza.
Why are you going to Old Country Buffet for that?
I mean, I like Hometown Buffet. I'm not going to rag on Hometown Buffet. There's a lot. Like, I get the meatloaf. I get everything
No, you go and you get everything. You don't get everything. Pizza.
She gets the pizza. I'm like, what's your favorite thing? She's like, the pizza. I'm like, okay. It's not even good pizza. Okay. But then I let her choose the movie, and I guess I kind of lucked out. I ended up at a good middle ground because the choices were Axel. I don't know if you've seen the previews for that gem.
No.
It's like a robot dog. And
Oh, good.
It's like, what if Monster Trucks wasn't passable? Monster Trucks? I think that's what the movie's called. Anyways, that house with the clock in the walls or something?
Yeah.
Ant-Man and Wasp, which I had already decided was maybe a little too much for her, some language in there that I'm not super comfortable with yet for her, but I was going to, you know, give it to her if she wanted it.
Sure.
Nope. She chose Teen Titans Go.
Ooh!
Which is a perfectly fine show.
Yeah.
She has been into watching. Are you familiar?
Oh, very much so.
Caught a couple episodes, maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, well, I also know who the Teen Titans are.
Okay, also, yes. I don't know if and you watch that show if you don't have a kid that's of age.
It's a little kiddie. It's a little too kiddie for me, but I've seen it, and I've seen the previews of the movie.
Okay, so it's really kinetic. Hyper-kinetic is how I describe the humor also. But sure. I laugh. It's one of the better ones, and I think we had heard good things about the movie, which is actually why she got into the show, because we were like, here, watch I have no one to blame but myself, is basically what I'm saying here.
Yeah.
So we ended up at that movie. You get more than you get with a TV show. There's lots of really cool kind of mixed media stuff going on there. There's a Disney riff on there. They use some Disney animation for a while. There's some flannel, like some stop motion in there. So it does lots of cool stuff with that. Uh-huh. It's that part plenty to appreciate. The story, I don't know if it transcends to commentary. I don't know if it can or should, you know, given what it is. But let me describe the plot to you.
All right.
The big bad is Slade Wilson.
Sure.
Ostensibly. But there's also a director in the movie called Jade Wilson. And the reason that's important is because it's basically a quest to get their own movie. Robin wants his own movie because he's seen all these superhero movies come out. And the world they create is funny because the superheroes are real, but so are the superhero movies. So, you know, you see Batman on the red carpet and The Flash and stuff like that. And they do some great bits with it. There's lots. I mean, it's kind of a gag show. There's lots of funny gags.
Sure,
lots of great jokes and one-offs. In fact, there's a Stan Lee cameo that happens more than once. It's really fun. And from what I can tell, it's his voice, too, which is, this is DC. And
Yeah. That's the humor. That's the gag.
It's funny. But the director has given every superhero their own movie, and the only superpowers they give for Slade Wilson are mind control. And it turns out, spoiler alert, Slade Wilson and Jade Wilson are one and the same. And Slade Wilson's plan from the beginning has been to mind control the world with superhero movies to the point where they're all zombies and that's all they want. And they are being mind manipulated, as he would have said. And that's what the Teen Titans have to fight against. Robin gets wrapped up in it because he wants his own movie, and he too becomes a superstar. You know, it's the whole solo career bit that you get from, you know, the storyline. You get
solo
from
last
movies.
Week. Check it out, Book Club for Movies.
No, it's not that solo storyline. Thank goodness. But again, I don't think it quite transcends into commentary, but that's a pretty on the nose, if funny.
Oh, yeah.
Bit,
yeah,
know?
For sure. No, that's so great.
Yeah, it's one to see. And I laughed out loud at the very end. They even comment on the lack of commentary, because they get to the end, they've saved the day, and they're like, wait, you know, what more was there, you know, like, what's the moral, like, what are we trying to say here? And I think it's Robin is like scrambling to get a moral out, and then as the credits are about to cut everything off, he just grabs the camera and is like, kids, ask your parents where babies come from. And then it ends.
I could dig that. That's fun.
Yeah. It's there's a lot to appreciate there. That's
cool.
That's my takeaway. That's my recommendation, I guess, for the week.
Fair
what
enough.
Do you got?
I got next to nothing. The wife and I had told her about Spotlight, and I had built that up, and I said, I will absolutely rewatch that movie again right away.
Sure.
And man, second time through. Yep. Still absolutely 100% knocks it out of the park. And I gave her the option. I said, okay, I really kind of want to watch either of these, but you know, whatever. She was like, at first she wanted to see The Post. And then I was like, okay, so, what about Spotlight? Are you interested in Spotlight or no? And she was like, well, okay, wait, which one's The Post? Which one is Spotlight? Is Spotlight's the one about the priests? And she was like, no, that's the one. I want to watch that.
Okay. She loved it. It's the better one. I mean,
she loved it. She liked it a lot. She liked it a lot, I should say.
Did
Thought
you do The Post
good.
Yet? I know it's
Not
on
yet.
The list.
Not
okay,
yet.
Okay.
Yeah. That is sitting
Never
there.
Mind then. Decide yeah. for yourself.
We will watch. but that's the only movie I watched. So,
okay.
That all being out. Said, here we go. Book Club for Movie Selection this month. We are going to be doing a full month. Maybe even a little over.
Maybe a little over, since we started late this month. We had planned this months ago, and as
yeah,
we do.
You know, it's fine. Forgot. We're going to do horror movies all month long. It's going to be a little, we're going to go all over the place. We're going to have some family stuff. We're going to have some more adult stuff, and we'll probably have something.
Some classics.
Some classics, perhaps. I think this week, I am so excited for this movie. I am so excited for this movie, because this is a movie the kids can watch, and I can't wait for Ryan to see it, because Ryan hasn't seen this yet.
I'm the kid here. Yeah.
I love this movie so much. We are going to be watching The Monster Squad. This is streaming right now on Amazon. So head over there, grab it, take a watchy poo. I love this movie. There is no chance that next week's discussion is not going to be very biased for me. but I'm not saying it's a perfect movie. Hey. It's definitely not. But here's the deal. This is also something I want to just bring up here. We are going to go into horror movies. We're going to watch these horror movies. I want to make sure everybody understands that these movies aren't necessarily going to be things that we have to dig too deep into. Some of these are just going to be fun.
Wow. Disclaimer,
and
huh?
Monster Squad, probably just going to be fun. However, I think there's a lot of cool stuff in there that is going to be fun to talk about. I think I know what next week's is going to be, and I think next week's will be a really, really big discussion.
Hey, I mean, talk about movies that do transcend into commentary. I mean, that Teen Titans movie couldn't do it, I think, because of what it was, and it's a kids movie. Again, I don't think you get that storyline in not a kids movie.
Sure.
Horror movies, also very kind of specific, very hyper-specific.
Oh, sure.
But do transcend. I think there's more, and there's going to be more to talk about than you might realize. Than other people might realize.
Monster Squad is going to have a couple of things for it. Like, there's going to be there's some interesting tropes to talk about, but there's also a couple of really, really nice underlying themes that kind of permeate it.
I love to get into the history of film, and I think horror is one of the more interesting histories, because it is tossed off so often.
Yeah, no, well, I mean, it has for a very long time been considered the lesser genre of almost everything.
We're going to prove them wrong.
But this week or this month, we've got a whole bunch of ideas, a whole bunch of movies that we could watch. If you guys have suggestions, we'd love to hear them.
We have a tentative list. Actually, we have one other movie that's a for sure, right?
There is one other movie that's a for sure, and that will be next week's
movie. Why
don't
you drop it? Like I said, we're all teased this show.
All right, next week after Monster Squad, that's this week's selection. Get that done this week. Next Thursday, we will be dropping Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the original from 1974. That, I'm not going to lie, I am super excited for you to watch Monster Squad and have
also
that talk.
Also have not seen that. Yeah.
I am super, super excited to actually discuss the film and everything that goes into what Texas Chainsaw Massacre is, what it turned into.
I can see it already. You have literally all of the trivia on this thing, don't you?
I don't.
Like,
no,
like
I don't.
Memorized. I see it coming out of your ears right now.
It's the best part. I don't know a ton of the trivia here. I don't know a lot. Like, I've seen the movie a whole bunch of times. I love the movie. One of the best things about Texas Chainsaw Massacre, it is not even a little bit what you think it is.
Okay. All right. So stay tuned for that one. The rest of the movies are literally just, we have a list and I haven't looked through them yet. So if you've got something to put on that list, it very well could go right to the top. So podcast@bookclub4movies.com. Send us an email, send us a suggestion, or you can Twitter, Facebook, or whatever. We'll take it from all. It doesn't matter. All comers welcome.
That's inappropriate.
.com. Yes, I understand that every life must end. As we sit alone, I know someday we must go on. Oh, I'm a lucky man to count on both hands the ones I love.